hyper-globalized and pluralistic world, misunderstanding is the source of much conflict. Sometimes misunderstanding comes from mere ignorance. Other times, misunderstanding is produced intentionally by formal and informal organizations that have an agenda to marginalize a certain group. For example, some of the negative images of trans folk in the media, TV, film, blogosphere, journalism, are based on sheer ignorance, while others seem to intentionally mischaracterize the nature of being trans. Either way, mischaracterization and misunderstanding of trans folk abounds in our culture, and we are just starting the process of understanding what it means to be trans. Since I am a trans woman and a philosopher, I want to contribute to this project in my own modest way. In this lecture, I want to accomplish two things. First, I want to identify and clarify some of the more important aspects of being transgender. I don't intend to give a complete primer on transgender issues, but to highlight some of what I take to be the most salient facts. I do this with the intention of raising awareness and increasing understanding, of course. But I also believe that there's something interesting to say about being transgender in a philosophical context. This brings me to my second task. I hope to argue that the very existence of transgender folk has implications for the nature of gender itself. To begin, let's review some terminology and facts related to trans people. The term transgender applies to anyone that does not identify with their assigned gender and/or sex characteristics. This might include people that identify as the opposite gender and people that don't identify exclusively as a man or a woman. The umbrella term for transgender individuals of the latter sort is non-binary and includes but is not limited to identities such as genderqueer, agender, bigender, gender fluid, and androgyne. The word transgender is an adjective and is used to modify a noun, as in transgender woman or transgender man. It's not a verb, nor is it a noun. Often trans is used as an abbreviated version of transgender, so trans man, trans man. The opposite of trans is cis, where a cis person identifies with the gender assigned to them at birth. Etymological use of those words is many, but not all, transgender folk experience what is commonly called gender dysphoria, or sometimes gender incongruence. This is a state of mental dissonance in which one feels discomfort associated with one's assigned gender and or one's primary and secondary sex characteristics. It usually arises in childhood or early puberty. In the DSM-5, Manual for Therapists, gender dysphoria is currently classified as a mental health condition in its own category, and it is worthy of note that gender dysphoria is not in the category of sexual disorders. Although gender identity disorder was so included in the previous volume of the DSM, it's important to reiterate that not all trans people experience gender dysphoria, and so being trans is not itself a mental health condition. There can be various reasons for being transgender, and this will become important later. I should also point out that the mental health condition that is identified as gender dysphoria doesn't include delusion as part of it. It's important to remember that. Although this was not the case, there can be various reasons for being transgender, and this will become important later. Although this was not always the case, the currently accepted treatment for gender dysphoria affirms transgender identities. It includes psychological counseling, which affirms one's inner sense of one's gender, and it includes access to various forms of medical transition, which include, but are not limited to, hormone replacement therapy, mastectomy, breast enhancement surgery, vaginoplasty, phalloplasty, and facial feminization surgery. It's important important to note that not all transgender individuals medically transition, and not all of those that do medically transition choose to have surgery. This affirmative approach to the treatment of individuals with gender dysphoria has been shown to increase the well-being of the patients and to reduce the likelihood of suicide, which is extremely high in those that experience gender dysphoria. As should be clear, gender dysphoria is a very serious condition. Importantly, this dysphoria can be broken down into two components. One, social dysphoria, which is the feeling of discomfort in relation to the social and or normative aspects of gender. And two, body dysphoria, which is the feeling of discomfort in relation to one's body with respect to its sexual characteristics. For example, a woman that is uncomfortable with the expectation that she will wear sexually appealing clothing, such as high heels, is experiencing social dysphoria. By contrast, body dysphoria might mean that a trans woman finds that certain aspects of her body cause her discomfort. Something about her body both feels and appears to be wrong. For example, while her teenage cis male peers might rejoice at finally getting facial hair, she might be terrified of it. Or she might think that her skin seems too rough, or that her fat distribution and musculature seems off, or that she finds her penis to be an alien appendage, and the list goes on. Something to note about this type of dysphoria is that it seems to involve some kind of clash or conflict between what the mind expects vis-a-vis one's sexual characteristics and the reality of the body. Of course, we are all affected by images of beauty that we see in the media, and sometimes these alone are enough to make us unhappy with our bodies. However, I believe that most trans folk that have body dysphoria would say that their discomfort is not about beauty per se, but about sexual characteristics of the body. This dysphoria persists somewhat independently of societal expectations about beauty. For example, in my case, prior to transitioning, I was a semi-competitive endurance cyclist. And I had a lean, muscular body that would have counted as a beautiful male body. My discomfort wasn't with the fact that I wasn't beautiful, but with my body being distinctly male in appearance. I found myself with a very primitive, visceral feeling of wrongness. Sometimes trans folk express this fact by saying that they were born in the wrong body. This resonates with me to some extent, except for the fact that I realize that I'm not in my body. I am my body. Instead, I prefer to use the metaphor of testosterone poisoning, indicating that although there is something wrong with my body, it isn't necessarily the wrong body. Presently, thanks to several years of HRT, my body is much further, I think, from the societal norms of beauty. And yet, I feel significantly better about it. In fact, the experience of taking hormones was an epiphany for me. In less than 2 weeks, I found myself waking up feeling more at home in my body. There were ways that I was uncomfortable prior to hormones that I didn't even know were bothering me. But after HRT, these aspects of my embodiment that I had taken for granted began to vanish. For example, although I wasn't cognizant of this fact, I was never really comfortable in my own skin. Now I am delightfully, delightfully comfortable. I feel like my skin needs to be soft. I don't know that I can completely describe how this feels except to use an analogy. It was like I had always worn a burlap sack and I switched it for a silk robe. Another example of how hormones helped me to understand the profound nature of my body dysphoria that I experience emotions different than I did before. My anger has diminished. This is a very good thing. But equally important, other emotions are more transparent to me. I feel physically more at one with my emotional states, where before I felt like I was fighting them. These two changes that arise from the use of hormones gave me a feeling of certainty that this was how I was meant to be. This experience was so overwhelming that I might, in a world. deign to use the word spiritual to describe it. Of course, there are skeptics out there that would question my experience. Some would say that it is a delusion of some sort that arises from a sexual fetish. But this discredited idea has been rejected by the scientific, medical, and clinical establishment. Several things have led to this more affirming approach to transgender care. First, the attempt to use conversion or reparative therapy with trans people, as well as with teens, lesbians, and bisexuals, was clearly disastrous. And by contrast, taking an affirming approach and enabling medical transition has proven to greatly improve the quality of trans people's lives. Suicide attempts go down to right around 10% instead of 80%. To be honest, this should be enough to convince anyone that an affirming approach is the way to go. Nevertheless, there is a second line of support for the affirming approach. This is the fact that scientists discovered that for trans women, a specific area in the brain near the hypothalamus matches cis women rather than cis men, and the same thing applies to trans men. The original study was conducted on the brains of dead persons, so one might wonder about that because trans women were using hormones. More recently, a study in the Netherlands was conducted with trans and cis children who had not yet started hormones, and it yielded the same result. Of course, we need to be careful about how to interpret these results. Sexual differentiation of the brain is very complicated. However, one suggestion is that there is some sexual differentiation of the brain that occurs in the womb based on the presence and balance of hormones. This differentiated area might then account for the persistent body dysphoria that some trans folk experience. In fact, this is the working theory of many of the experts in the field. It is important to note that this explanation is not an explanation of the existence of trans folk, but an explanation of the persistence of body dysphoria. Trans folk sometimes don't experience any gender dysphoria, or sometimes they experience only social dysphoria. There can be other legitimate causes of transness. Many non-binary trans individuals reject the gender binary itself as being an oppressive machine. This political reason for being trans is just as legitimate as a psychological reason. A trans tree has many roots. My reason for affirming this is that it is the only position that avoids what is called gatekeeping is the restriction of who has access to medical transition procedures and or who is permitted to use the word transgender in self-identification by the trans community. This practice of gatekeeping has kept many trans people from being able to receive the affirming treatment that would save their lives. For example, over a decade ago, I attempted to start hormones by seeking a therapist that was an expert on gender issues. Instead, she refused to give me a permission letter, which I had to get to start hormones without. Diagnosed me with borderline personality disorder and claimed that I was too unstable to transition. For some reason, I accepted this uncritically. But I later found out that this very typical tactic employed by non-affirming therapists to keep trans women from being able to transition. This tactic almost cost me my life, as my suffering from body dysphoria led me into a suicidal decade. Frankly, I'm lucky to be alive right now. Gatekeeping has real consequences, sometimes deadly ones. Imagine if someone refused to give you a life-saving treatment for a heart condition due to the fact that you were emotionally unstable. I fail to see that this is not analogous to the case of the gatekeeping of the trans community. Gatekeeping also happens in the trans community by those that believe that gender dysphoria is an essential characteristic for trans folk. They assert that those that don't medically transition or that don't have body dysphoria are not really trans. This practice, of course, is just the same gatekeeping that trans folk face from the faced and still face from the clinical establishment. As such, it must be rejected. And this means that we must recognize the plurality of the roots of being transgender. Recall that I claimed that the existence of transgender people has implications for the very nature of gender. So let's switch gears and turn to the philosophical consideration of the nature of gender. I won't give a full-fledged theory of the nature of gender because that would take a book. However, I will gesture in that direction. To begin, let me summarize what I take to be some of the traditional influential theories of gender. Instead, I should say theory types, since these aren't theories per se, but general categories that theories might fall in. The first type of theory about the nature of gender is usually called essentialism. This is the view that gender is not a social fact, but a mind-independent, metaphysical fact about our very nature. According to this view, there are essential differences between men and women that make them what they are. Gender is binary and fundamentally bifurcated. Sometimes essentialists are of a religious persuasion, and their understanding of the essence of gender is spiritual or transcendent. Other times, more often, essentialists base their essentialism in biology, arguing that the biology of men and women makes them essentially different. Essentialists sometimes use their view to defend conservative approaches to the gender regime. Religious gender essentialists often use their view to dominate women and LGBTQI folk. By contrast, gender critical radical feminists, sometimes called trans exclusionary radical feminists, are also essentialists about sex. They don't like religion. But they use this to argue that men are always potentially oppressive and violent, as well as to argue that trans women are not real women and thus should be excluded from women's spaces. Essentialism of whatever variety has problems. The first problem is the existence of gender nonconformity. If something is truly essential, then there cannot be any counterexample. But there clearly are gender non-conforming counterexamples to practically every aspect of being male or female. Moreover, many cultures construct gender in a way that allows for more options than just male and female. This fact torpedoes the idea that gender is naturally binary. Speaking of which, biology itself does a good job of repeating the idea that gender play biological sex is binary. There are many karyotypes, not just two. There are many presentations of genitalia. We have a whole spectrum of distributions of hormones throughout our bodies at different points of time in our lives. Some cis women have more testosterone than most cis men. Some cis men have more estrogen than most cis women. The binary falls apart with the biological perspective on sexual differentiation. Another type of theory of gender is social constructivism. Here, gender is seen as a non-natural social convention by climate. Social constructivists might tether the conventions to natural characteristics of the world, but many of the prominent constructivists don't. We might call the constructions or conventions employed by the latter type of constructivist free-floating, since they are not tethered to the natural world. One very prominent constructivist is Duke Butler. Starting from an insight due to J.L. Austin that we perform actions with language in addition to describing the world, Butler argues that gender is performative. Just as some linguistic performances make something a reality that wasn't before, gender's reality, though, in an example of that, the bride or the groom at a wedding saying, "I do," that makes it reality. Gender's reality comes from the performative nature of our interactions, clothing, body presentations, expectations, etc. That is, gender arises from our performance of gender. And this is clearly, I think, relatively a free-floating convention. Although I'm not sure that Butler would claim that it's completely untethered A positive characteristic of this approach is that it handles gender nonconformity very well. If we didn't naturally fit these norms, then some of us would resist them. And given this easy explanation of gender nonconformity, and also the fact that different cultures have different gender regimes, there seems to be a lot to recommend the constructivist view. However, even this view has problems. One problem is that it doesn't account for body dysphoria. As Jay Prosser has argued at length in his book Second Skins, which is about the philosophy of transgender issues, he argues, Butler seems to ignore the body in her account of gender. To be sure, Butler is a trans-friendly philosopher, and we certainly need those in today's environment. But her approach to the metaphysics of gender ignores one of the most salient characteristics of many, but not all, trans people's experiences. Julia Serrano, a trans activist, slam poet, and biologist, proposes a theory of gender that she variously calls the intrinsic inclinations model and the bio-experiential model. According to her view, the existence of body dysphoria shows that we have in our psychological makeup something she calls our subconscious sex. This is our inner sense of our sex. She does mean to focus on sex here rather than gender. And by the way, the difference between those in the literature is essentially that gender has to do with social aspects, sex has to do with biological aspects, but it's really hard to tease those apart, so I don't think that distinction. So this is our inner sense of sex, which is composed, as subconscious sex, is our inner sense of sex, which is composed of inclinations, expectations, and preferences. Cis folk do not notice this because it matches their embodied sexual identity. By contrast, trans people with body dysphoria notice a mismatch between their bodies and their subconscious sex. We notice things more often when something goes wrong than when they go right. So Serrano thinks that this subconscious sex then provides us with the material on which we construct gender. That is, Serrano argues, gender is still a social and individual construct, but it is tethered to subconscious sex as revealed by body dysphoria. Since subconscious sex is based on subconscious inclinations, it will be a matter of degree, and this will account for why gender can be constructed in various ways and why some people would identify outside the gender binary. Now, I think that there is a lot to recommend in Serrano's view, and surely it's partially correct. But it should be clear, given the first section of this lecture, that it leaves out a very important aspect of being trans. Indeed, not every trans person has gender dysphoria, and of the ones that do, many of them do not have body dysphoria. But Serrano's view is rooted in an analysis of body dysphoria, and it ignores the other desires that might motivate being trans. In so doing, her theory is not sufficiently general. We need to account for the plurality of the roots of trans, and indeed the plurality of the roots of gender. The problem is, as feminists Audre Lorde and bell hooks have pointed out, gender is good at resisting a universal characterization. It seems to me, instead, that we might look at characterizing gender in terms of a convergence of various desires. My gender is certainly related to body dysphoria, which plays a significant factor in how I articulate my own sense of identity. But other trans folk don't have the same sort of desire. Their motivations might arise from their rejection of the norms of the gender binary, they see as an oppressive regime. By the way, I agree that gender binary is oppressive, but that's not my reason for identifying as trans. To push the root metaphor, gender is like a multi-rooted and multi-branched tree, but instead of having the roots descending from a unified organism, they are separate organisms that converge into a symbiotic collective. So there it is, my gesture toward a theory of gender. And by gesture, I mean a metaphorical attempt to sort of capture the logistics of how gender is constructed. This isn't yet a theory, since that would require a an in-depth analysis of the nature of desire vis-a-vis gender and sex, as well as an analysis of the various roots of how the various roots of gender converge. Finally, I would like to talk a little bit about one implication of this type of approach to the nature of gender. The current gender regime is oppressive. In particular, it is used to oppress women and anyone that is gender nonconforming. Your legally recognized gender is forced on you based on an examination of your genitalia, as if your genitalia determine who you are. This is gender authoritarianism. Given the fundamentally oppressive nature of the current gender regime, one suggestion is that we abolish gender. I think that this view would certainly make sense if a theory like Butler's were correct. For if gender is produced by a certain performativity in how we live, and this performativity is constructed merely to oppress us, then we should eliminate it. We should construct a post-gender world. I think that this picture of what's going on, or what we should do, is too simple and possibly dangerous. If gender were constructed as a framework merely to oppress people with no connection to our natural desires, then it would be harder to get it to stick. The better approach, from the oppressor's point of view, is to tie gender to some typical desires and inclinations, thus encouraging everyone to conform to the constructive stereotypes. In other words, make the stereotype somewhat natural and it will stick. Then you just have to twist the stereotype to serve your oppressive ends. So tethering gender constructs to the world of our desires is an efficient move. And I think that this gives us some reason to think that this is exactly how it goes. If gender has other roots that are not related to its usefulness for oppressors, then it needn't be oppressive. If this is right, then the abolition of gender is not necessary, and even maybe too extreme. One problem would be that many people feel quite comfortable identifying within the gender binary. How would we enforce gender abolition? What would we do with such people who identify with a gender? Would those people that prefer identifying with a gender be sent to do reparative therapy to make sure that they were no longer? Instead of gender abolition, I think that we should advocate gender autonomy. This approach gives everyone the right to identify as the gender they wish, for whatever reason. The positive aspect to this approach is that enforcement is not needed. We can let gender evolve organically on its own. This approach allows that gender isn't unrelated to what I think are perfectly healthy desires. This approach is partially conciliatory with gender abolition, since it's consistent with the abolition of much of the old gender regime, including legal differences between men and women, harmful stereotypes of both men and women, and gender-segregated professions or industry. Moreover, if we achieve gender autonomy, then it's quite possible that this will lead to the fading away of the importance of gender, and maybe even to something like de facto gender abolition. There are, of course, many other issues surrounding trans people, such as pronouns, gender-segregated spaces, trans participation in sports, etc. And I just don't have time to address these. Indeed, I imagine that I've already surpassed the average time of a TED Talk, so I'm going to leave it here and open the floor for questions. But before I do, let me just briefly summarize my argument. I have argued that being transgender is not equivalent to having gender dysphoria. Additionally, the latter involves two types of dysphoria, social and body dysphoria. Essentialist theories of sex or gender fail to account for gender nonconformity, and free-floating social constructivist views of gender fail to account for body dysphoria. The alternative is to embrace a constructivist model that tethers refers gender to aspects of the world, and in particular, desire. Moreover, the roots of gender vis-a-vis gender, or sorry, the roots of desire vis-a-vis gender are plural, and hence gender involves a convergence of desires that arise from different causal factors. One implication of this approach is that we should conceive of gender liberation as gender autonomy rather than gender abolition. Almost any question about this topic.
So you suggest that there is a gender regime in the church and the authoritarian. Who is responsible for that? Who's exercising power? Where does the gender regime originate? And who's exercising that power? And then, if so, why are they so heavily invested?
It's diffuse. The path of it, so to use the Coase notion of biopolitical, it's a diffuse kind of power that's being exercised here. It's not just one institution, but some of the institutions fall on the state. They require that you identify, that you have a gender identified with the underlying being and so on. And of course, gender should not be legal status at all. But also the medical. And of course, from the point of view of medicine, sexual traits does that. So, for example, despite the fact that I'm transitioning, I still have to be checked for, say, prostate. Although I also have to get a mammogram check for breast cancer. So, obviously, the sexual characteristics of someone's body have to be taken into account in medicine. We've oversimplified that and made it male or female, when in fact it actually should be more like, oh, well, this person has an XXY karyotype and these levels of hormones and so on. And then that background can help form medical decisions about what so it seems like to me that, yeah, to a large extent, it is the scientific and medical establishment that enforces this. Although, in fact, even in the scientific establishment, there was for a long time basically the wrong view about sexual differentiation and how it works. The idea was that the chromosomes determine everything. We're finding out that the chromosomes determine some, but not very much, actually. A lot of decisions are made along the way by other factors in your body and in your environment while you're developing. So it's not at all this idea that hit the chromosome domino and then all the rest of the dominoes fall down. Right? That's not how it works. So I think the scientific community, at least the ones who are experts on the biology of sex, have pretty much undone this whole binary, and they don't think in those terms anymore. Although in high school biology we still think in those terms. They basically teach the loneliness biology, basically. They'll teach you theory of evolution and what they do is teach you correctly. They don't teach biology of sex appropriately. At least based on my experience, because I'm teaching the students for big classes. So yeah, I think obviously there are cultural aspects too. Capital. A lot of gender differentiation came from the capitalists in the 19th century realizing, hey, you know, we can get people to buy even more clothing or different types of clothing, if we could make clothing seem like there's gender, right, for children. See, at the time, children always, before they hit puberty, basically wore the same clothes, so just androgynous clothes for all kids, and some clothing company, you know, the idea that they could make children's clothing that was gender-coded. And of course, they started off with pink was boys, is girls, but I think that capitalism does, or capitalism and the capitalist do play a role in this as well. And obviously, I don't want to say that here. Other questions?
So you mentioned that this typically comes in this like self conversation starts at a younger age or in the wisdom tree. And I feel like in the community that I'm a part of and I'm familiar with, and even in the media even, it seems a lot that this comes to fruition later into adult life. And so I'm wondering, do you think that there is a shift that's coming on earlier set? And is that because of societal changes or expectations? Or is that something that it's really just like a self-identification process that can happen later in life?
It is the case that different trans people sort of discover their status at different times. I think that to a large extent, when people actually come out, that's determined by societal expectations. I knew although I didn't have the name for it, but I knew specifically that I had this issue when I was 9. And then when I was just after I got back from my LDS mission, I actually was able to articulate it without using the word transgender. And I made, at that point, a conscious decision to repress it and try to live my Mormon life where I'm supposed to. Mm-hmm. And I've been aware for a long time. It didn't come out until I knew that at least enough of the population would accept me that I wouldn't feel completely alone. Because in the 80s and 90s, when I grew up, trans people were not even accepted by the most progressive people. Even the LGBT community, even though the T is in there, they did not accept trans people, and they still don't to a large extent.
With the gender autonomy, what would you propose with young, like, parents and young children in terms of naming preferences?
So with respect to children, I would say when they have issues, gender issues come up for a lot of kids, not just for trans kids. Because after all, we do attach a lot to gender. We really shouldn't be, right? Math is supposed to be male, and literature is supposed to be female, that kind of stuff. And that's a bunch of crap, right? Obviously, we should throw that kind of stuff out. And so I think if you look at what's going on with kids and allow them the freedom to just kind of explore and tell you the way that they want to be understood, allow them to explore that during their childhood before they hit puberty. That's the best way to approach that. Importantly, when you're trans and if you are identified as trans when you're a child, you don't go on hormones, really, obviously. Mm-hmm. Right? In fact, what you do is at puberty, you'll start your hormone treatment. Sometimes, children want a little longer to make decisions about whether they want to do this because some of the effects of hormones are irreversible. So people in this field invented medicines that can block puberty, in essence, and allow for a couple more years to make that kind of decision. And I embrace that. If that had happened in my life would have been dramatically different and better. Because I would have known that there was such a thing as being transgender, but also I would have been able to not have a male puberty, which is what really, really causes a lot of disorder.
So under the auspices of gender autonomy, with gender roles, physiology, and social body and dysphoria, how does gender reassignment surgery and hormone therapy to add a sense of if our sexual genitalia is a finer gender and the hormones in their body are finer gender, why engage in that process and accept that the risks associated with gender reassignment surgery and the not brain risk of hormone therapy, but some of the effects?
Yeah. Well, there are some risks with hormones. But that's like the hormones that I take are the same hormones that make me menopause. And so these are risks that you don't know about with respect to other things that people use these hormones. Sometimes people use Trump uses one of the T blockers that I use to try to get started with that. And a lot of people with acne use one of the other T blockers that I use to reduce their acne, especially when usually it's women.
And
of course, the medicine is always associated with self-medicine. The surgeries are also, of course, associated with this. Although the people who are competent at it are actually really quite good. So doctors from Thailand, for example, have been doing this for a long time. They're really quite good at least bottom surgery for trans women. There's a philosophical question, and that's the important part. How is it, if genitalia shouldn't determine who you are, then why do trans people need to So, but notice something, this is important. A lot of trans people who do want to medically transition, including surgeries, it's very often going to be motivated by body dysphoria. And body dysphoria is visceral. It's not something that goes away just because. So for example, if you can ask anybody who knows me, for 10 years, for a whole decade before I finally decided to medically transition, I identified as genderqueer. I didn't change my pronouns, but I identified outside the binary. And I really broke the rules if I was supposedly male, right? I mean, I was gender non-conforming, but that didn't do anything. It made me feel more free in terms of society, but I'm already kind of everybody else is wrong. Let's overthrow the government. I don't really care much about societal norms, but yet I still the dysphoria that I experienced when I was 9 for the first time, and then really intensely when I was 21. That dysphoria just didn't go away. It actually got more and more intense as I became more built up on this complex musculature. I used to be the amount of testosterone in my system. I used to not have the pressure there. So all of that made me really uncomfortable. And so I felt like I needed to transition. Now, not everyone who's trans. In fact, I would say that the majority of people who have gender dysphoria and who identify as trans, who medically transition, just do hormones. It's pretty common for both trans women and trans men to decide not to do genital surgery, which is really the way you should refer to that. Don't call it sex reassignment surgery. Sometimes it's called gender confirmation surgery. Better to just call it what it is, vaginoplasty or phalloplasty. So, also, I should mention this. Something I want to write about in the future. I want to write a paper entitled The Feminine Penis. And the reason is that hormones changes everything. Really significantly. I don't know how much it changes. Changes sexual function, your skin, your emotions, your capillaries, your ability to recover from damage in your body, and so on. It just changes the body. It's really difficult physically. The word before I transitioned, one of the big changes is how genitalia work. So trans men who are taking testosterone, their clitoris will become in many ways more like a penis in size, but also in function and how the orgasm feels and that kind of stuff. And similarly, the other way for trans women, the trans woman's penis does not function like a cis man's penis. And it does not, this is important just in case you have some mystical undoubted, but you have the experience of porn. But if you happen to watch any trans porn, it's important to realize that they're using drugs other than hormones to help with their performance, because there's a cis male expectation about how trans women are. Their penises work just like normal men's penises for the rest of them. Right? That's sort of the expectation, and that it's just not like that. It doesn't function that way at all. So I have no since hormones, I haven't been as dysphoric about that aspect of my body. I'm actually much less dysphoric. So much so, I, at this point, probably won't that surgery. Although, by contrast, I am really interested in getting facial feminization surgery because I have a lot of dysphoria associated with the bone structure. Go ahead.
So it's not disruptive.
Yeah. Why don't we do that? So if you need to go to a class, feel free to leave right now, and I can continue answering questions for a while. I have another class, but I told them I'd come late, so they'll be waiting for me.
I saw you really
disruptive.
Looking out.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, the Epic Center, I think, is close to being a
website.
Blair, you had a question.
Yeah, so I want to just put it back on the gender regime. It requires a little bit of practice, but I really want to get your take on it. So you see with like the bisexual community, the idea of homosexual and homosexual being mutually exclusive categories where people can't identify. So with people with gender variant biology, or people who are intersex, the labels cisgender and transgender aren't necessarily mutually exclusive categories, because some of us can be identified as women but still have to medically transition to be a woman, be an air quote, what that means. So what is your feeling, your thoughts, your takes on people who have gender variant biology or intersex conditions identifying with both cisgender and transgender experiences and not mutually exclusive categories?
Yeah, so that's really
I don't know what to call myself.
So one of the problems, let me get a little context here, because you know, a lot more people are intersex than you think. There's probably somebody that you know that's intersex that doesn't even know that they're intersex. It's awesome if that's the case. That might raise some interesting questions about the nature of sex and gender. Obviously, intersex culture that I wasn't thinking about them too much while I was writing this. Also, a little bit more background, I think it's pretty clear that to some extent, the queer or the gay community, gay and lesbian community, set up new binaries. New binaries that were questioned by the bisexual. And that's why bisexuality is kind of radical in the queer community, because it questions that dichotomy that heterosexual is a homosexual, right? It seems like this keeps happening, where there's a binary, we undo it, and then the people who undo that binary set up another one, right? I think that what you're arguing is that, this is happening again with the trans community. Maybe.
It could be. Well, and it's not necessarily that, again, we're back to bisexuals, that homosexual or heterosexual is bad. It's neither is bad, and you can identify it either, but there are some people who identify as both.
Yeah.
So is that okay?
Yeah.
Like, because in the gender gatekeeping, the gender politics, because the queer community and things like that. But, when it comes to gatekeeping, for someone to say they have a trans experience or whatever, there's kind of a spectrumness to that experience, is there not?
Yeah, I think that that's right. That's right. In fact, I think if you start to, at least in one way, if you start to think really carefully about the issue and about all of the factors that play a role in it, everyone's open.
I know.
And the reason that I say this is that you're not always comfortable with your gender, even if you're cis.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I think this is really important. It cannot, this stuff that we're talking about cannot be dichotomous. The binary doesn't apply to it because biological sex is clearly not binary. It is a matter of degree. It's what I would call a multi-dimensional spectrum. because it has to do with a lot of different factors, where each one of which is a spectrum. And so you could be non-binary in a certain respect, in terms of your biological sex, and I am. I've got a penis and breasts. That's non-binary in terms of my biological sex, right? So I think that there's something right with the idea that trans and cis are not completely exclusive.
I just wanted to, you had mentioned in passing about your relationship to the fact that T is in the LGBTQ line. And I was wondering if you care to let us know what forms of exclusion you've experienced.
So a lot of trans men gay men, I have noticed, treat trans women in a way that it's almost as if they believe that trans women are really gay and just gay wrong. In fact, if you look at the movie Boys Don't Cry, and you read some of the reviews about it at that time, you'll see that that's essentially how the gay community responded to that film, is to say that this person was lesbian but didn't know how to articulate it because she lived in Iowa or whatever. And so there's that. A specific instance of a way in which trans people's voice is not heard as much. The Love Loud Festival last year, where some of the bathrooms were supposed to be gender neutral, trans woman in the bathrooms was forced out of there by people who were organizers of the concert. Yeah, sort of. those would be a couple of examples of that. Also, there are it's not like a huge phenomenon, but it is a phenomenon that's big enough in the UK, for example. There are lesbian feminists who believe strongly that the transgender agenda, as they call it, my agenda is communism. but the transgender agenda, as they call it, is trying to fit into the heterosexual, heteronormative structure, trying to make homosexual people into the right gender so that they'll fit the heteronormative structure, right? Mm-hmm. So some radical lesbian feminists are going to argue that transgender is, again, misunderstanding queerness, and it's a distortion. So they're essentially trying to erase trans. So that's sort of what that's kind of talking about. I say that the team has not always been accepted in that queer elements. Oh, John.
Well, just brought up your comments. I'm curious how you feel like communist politics influence, or how communist social protests are doing on gender politics.
Oh yeah, that's interesting and important. One of the things I like about the communist approach to politics is that it's a materialist, that it looks at the actual material reality and analyzes things in terms of material reality, which of course means that Marxists are going to they're not going to ignore the body, right? They're not going to ignore that. And so, for the most part, we find that Marxists are actually pretty trans-friendly. That said, although the Soviet Union legalized homosexuality early on, they then, under Stalin, criminalized it again, and then, of course, later legalized it again. So they changed their mind on that. Cuba also did think they actually had anti-gay laws, policies up to 70s, and then changed that too, following science. There's obviously some issues. One of the most prominent trans activists, and one of the early ones, in fact, I think they're one of the Leslie Feinberg was a fairly well-known communist in the United States, wrote a book called Transliberation. And it takes basically materialist approach to the nature of gender, and she argues for a very positive affirming approach to transgender, and connects the gender regime to the broader capitalist regime and the kind of oppression that happens there. But that said, though, there are communists who are anti-trans as well. So all of those intersect to some extent, but not.
Yeah, I'm really interested in your terminology thing that testosterone poisons your body. So I guess my question is, so in an ideal world, would you have been born the right gender, or are trans people necessary for an ideal world?
I don't know. I don't know if it, I am who I am because of my past. And although sometimes I regret things, and I really do wish I could have been positioned to be a I wish society had accepted gender. So in some ways, I do regret things, and I wish things could have gone differently. I wouldn't want to. Okay, so I'm going to take your question a little bit differently. I wouldn't, if there were a pill that you could take that would go into your brain and change that part of my of the brain that is making me feel like this stuff is wrong, and make it so that I would feel okay with being having a male body, I wouldn't. And here's why. Because my sense of identity is more of who I am than my body is, than this, the physical aspects, the secondary sex characteristics. So for me, changing secondary sex characteristics is way more important than being born feeling, you know, at home in your body. I mean, I would have liked to have been born. I would have liked to have been born with the kind of anatomy that my mind seems to expect. Claire.
Yeah, it's kind of like this guy's question here. I would love to hear any experiences you've had with gender euphoria and how things like transitioning and things like that had helped those things.
So there's this idea, or there's this concept of gender euphoria, which is sort of the opposite of gender dysphoria. When I got on hormones, I experienced that. I mean, that epiphany that I'm talking about was essentially gender euphoria. Wow, this is, the biggest thing was my skin. And also emotional state. So those two are by far the biggest. And I didn't even realize that that was what was going to be the biggest thing. I was worried about my hair, once I started feeling differently, I was like just riding high for months. It's euphoric for people who have had to live their whole lives pretending to be somebody else, which I consciously did because to be able to all of a sudden just be the way you want to be, wear what you want to wear, act the way you want to act, have people interact with you the way you want to be interacted with, it's euphoric.
Is there social things around that as well that introduce euphoria? So like if people in here are like, what can I do to create spaces for that euphoria socially? The things that are not.
Yeah, there is. So, or
like how did it feel to find someone called Kelly?
When people get that right, when I go out in public and people get my gender right, they don't miss it. Which actually, interestingly, in like the transaction world, the world of capital, in that world, they almost always get it right. So that's actually kind of, I, Bonnie and I will go into a restaurant and they'll, you know, ask, they'll say, I don't know. But still, I mean, here, and then there, and then there.
So how do we apply gender autonomy to things like draft, sports, and other things where that we almost depended and kind of reduced the binary gender as a crutch to create gender roles and social learning? How do we start taking that process?
Yeah, well, okay, so one thing I did sort of mention this in the paper, but only briefly. I think that we should eliminate any reference to gender in any of the papers. And so, if there's going to be a draft, then there shouldn't be a draft, because that's just like, there's going to be a draft. Oh, sorry, that was the same. That's bad. It's just a draft. But if there is going to be a draft, then it should be a draft. I also think bathroom should be unisex, and we should ensure privacy in another way. In a lot of Europe, the bathrooms, the individual stalls go all the way to the ground. Their doors are shut, and they're totally private and good. It should be that way. If people need privacy that much, then that's the way we should approach it. And not. Yeah, so I mean, that's how I would handle those situations. Of course, that's a radical change. With respect to sport, I'm not enough of an expert to have a definite opinion on this. But I will say this, the current International Olympic Committee's approach is to say, okay, trans men, yeah, they can start participating in sports, or whatever, they can start doing it. There's no limit on that. But trans women, that's where the issue is, because they might have had faith. They have a male puberty, and that gave them a body structure that they might not have had if they didn't have the male puberty, right? They have more muscle mass, and so on. I have to say, though, I was a competitive cyclist, and I promise you that there's no way I would be one now. If I trained exactly like I trained before, I would not. And I'm not, and I'm saying among the women, because I know how fast they are. I used to race against them at the same time that the women were racing, and so I could see where I was with respect to the women. And yeah, before I started hormones, I would have probably done fairly well in the women's category, but I wouldn't have ever won up any of the races. I was always the guy who won the career. But now I'm nowhere. Last year, I was unable to do the alpine business meetings that I had. I couldn't even ride the ride that I used to ride all the time, because being on hormones, that has changed some significant things. One of the things is capillaries. Your capillaries are contracted, they're smaller, and as a result, you just don't get as much blood to your muscles and so on. So with trans women who are on hormones are basically taking a drug that is a performance D-enhanced drug, right? And so what the Olympic Committee has decided is that trans women can participate as long as their testosterone levels are below a certain level that they indicate as kind of the high end of for women. Right? So now, I mean, I understand that it's complicated. There haven't been a lot of studies done on it. The studies that have been done indicate that there's not a directly proportional relationship between performance and testosterone. We like to think that that's the case. We talk about it in everyday discourse as if testosterone leads to performance and testosterone. But there's not a direct, the link is much more indirect than you might think. And some sports that you think testosterone would totally help with, there's no evidence that that's the case.
My question was just, it seems to me that things are changing really rapidly as we're trying to understand all these like areas that don't fit inside of the binary. So would you say it's a reasonable solution to just have like one set of pronouns outside of male or female, outside of traditional he and she, and then like that pronoun just encompass the like, mystery of and like the areas of discovery.
Well, I actually think we should just go to gender
for everyone.
Some languages already have that in church.
Yeah, because all looks like that.
And I'm actually thinking that there's a good chance that in the future, if things go the direction they're going, we will eventually just give them areas of matter. Because you can always get whether it's through the conference. So,
yeah.
I'm trying to go because it has been said that it will take a little bit longer, but I think that's the problem. How you said about sex and gender, do you think that it's difficult to differentiate the sex and history? I would like it to go through. Do you think this?
Yeah, well, I mean, so essentially what we've got is when we talk about sexual characteristics, we talk about male and female sexual. That isn't at all a natural way to do it. Male and female, where are we getting that from? We're getting it from the social context. A natural way to do it would be to break things down and you end up with a classification system that is a huge flow chart with over, you know, with lines crossing each other. It's biological sex, just I can refer you to somebody to read on this. Butler is actually really good about this. She, in response to the kinds of criticisms I made today, she argues that biological sex is constructed too, not just social gender. It's constructed, and she's right. If it's just male and female, if it's binary, and that's the way we're talking about biological sex, that is a construction, and it's kind of a misleading one. So I would say. In bodies that matter. Maybe an undoing gender.
This would go on to the side of the chromosome, but we don't have the only sex, and that's just
why. Yeah, there's XX, Y as a possibility, there's X only as a possibility. Some women have XY, and that because of another condition they have called androgen insensitivity, testosterone doesn't take the effect on their bodies. Right? This is one of the intersex conditions. So there's intersex can happen at the level of chromosomes. It can happen later because of hormonal balances in the womb, right? So it's not just chromosomes that are determining factors. If you're a fraternal twin and your twin is of the other gender, other sex, then the hormones in the womb will be different than if you weren't. And as a result, you'll have more of an effect on testosterone in your body. Female fraternal twin, or the other way around, if you're male fraternal twin. It's a complicated thing. I highly suggest reading Joan Roughgarden's book, Evolution's Rainbow, it's called Diversity Sexual Biology. I think here. Since I've transitioned, men should be different than before, and it's really and condescending terms like that are used. I think that's, and I had no idea. I'm so sorry. I did not know how bad it is to be a woman in the world. It's really actually difficult. Like, for example, I used to walk around at night in big cities and not be all that bright. Now I'm actually pretty, you know, tense because I know what sometimes happens. I am prepared to things. And also, men will just talk to me out of the blue because for some reason they think that if you're women, you just talk to me. And it's really, really scary and weird. I have discovered statues.
I like it. Oh, I was just gonna say, I have to say, you're just looking at that concept I never even thought about before. I mean, I've understood gender as kind of spectrums, or you know, across a plane of multiple points. But I've never even thought about sex in that way.
mention that. I have a child in social health hospital, and what a lot of people don't know about autism is that it's not only one thing; it's multiple symptoms. We say in the community that if you have one child with autism, you have one child with autism. The thing that just the light that went off in my head when you said that is that, it would be more useful for us, particularly medically speaking, scientifically speaking, I think perhaps if we stop looking at sexes, like you said, male, female, but as not symptoms, but they've got this characteristic, like so, like a flow chart, or perhaps like a plane, and marking different points on that plane.
Yeah.
This individual has these, and perhaps that might even lead to more revolutionary treatments for different conditions that apply to things that we identify as sex now. Sorry, I'm not trying to, I wanted to formulate this as a question, if you know what you're
I do think that there's a book by a scholar of science, Ann Foster Sterling, called The Myths of Gender, and it's really good in terms of undoing some of the things that we think must attach to female. It's a great book to look at. Shows how the science has been sexist with regard to genders. But she argues, I think it's in that book, but it might actually be before it, she argues that based on the biology that we have, if we were to construct gender in the most natural way, sort of cutting the world at its natural joints, we have five genders. That's what she argues. You might look at her work with respect to this. Now, I actually am thinking what we ought to do is say, this is my carrier type. These are my level of hormones, right? This is the genitalia, which, by the way, in one out of every 1,000 cases, genitalia is ambiguous. And you know how this is just horrible, but you know how they decide? Well, when it's ambiguous, of course, they do an operation and they just stipulate this is a male or female. At least this was the time. A lot of places are now banned. Portugal is totally banned. California is banned.
Chile
is banned. What they used to actually have they had a phallometer. How long the clit or penis or phallus that was there, how long that is, that's what I think it was an inch. That's what determines whether they decide, okay, we're gonna do a phalloplasty or a vaginoplasty. And of course, when they do this on intersex people, 10% of them, at least, if not more, end up not identifying with the gender that they were assigned. And they have dysphoria, right? And so in essence, their condition is exactly the same as a trans person's condition, right? They end up with dysphoria. In fact, a lot of trans people end up being trans is just having intersex brain.
So when Angela was pregnant with our 8-year-old, the physician told us after we did ultrasound, oh, you're having a boy. Right, so you come up with this traditional boy, well, it's not traditional, it's inserted in my love. When the child is born, right, the doctor immediately added, it's a girl. And so then me and my wife are holding this baby and like, who are you? Right? So then we have like, oh, we gotta come up with a boy's name, etc. Right? And so my question is how possible is it to avoid assigning gender? Right? So, as a parent, looking back, if you were to have a child now, what considerations would you have naming, referring to your child?
If I had a child now, I would raise that child. On this issue, Scandinavia, Norway, the Netherlands, parents raise their children in a different way. It's possible to do that, and they end up being really interesting kids. So that's how I would do it. I mean, I would make sure that they understand that gender is something that's out there in the world, right? And they, of course, might want to identify.
I
the book that explaining the traditional view of biological sex. So now that we're accepting the role of suffering, can you imagine how the conversations are different now explaining where they are?
Oh, yeah. Well, it's to me that biologically we still explain that it's sort of the same way, right? At least the biological aspect. We might also notice that the sex
are
usually.
Are you talking about a man and a woman or something?
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah. I mean, no. See, that's what I would say is we would describe it in a biological way.
Exactly.
A person with. Yeah, exactly. That's how I would do it. Yeah. And I would also say this. I mean, I relevant to your question, but not exactly what you're asking, but I would say that we ought to recognize that sex is not just coitus. It's not just coital sex. In fact, the idea that sex is coitus is vaginal sex, typical sex that heterosexuals have. Thinking that sex is coitus, and that's the sexual relationship that people have, is a very heteronormative idea. Sex is not coitus. Sex is a lot of different types of things that we do. And so opening that up and allowing that sex is much more than just coitus, I think that would be important.
Even with babies, all kinds of different scenarios.
Yeah, there's. Yes, exactly.
But there's lots of different ways that happens, right? We have in vitro fertilization, all sorts of things. But is that more just that?
I'm just curious here. So, in the world that we, the society that we live in, and politics, being involved with this whole, not just, you know, transgender, but like intersectionality all across the board in America, how would you, you know, we can talk about this, discuss this in an informative manner here in education, how would we go about doing that outside of an institutional education and make it a mainstream known? I mean, since, you know, you address the issues yourself, you know, of some peers that maybe you would never have thought, you know, experiencing, how would you do that in a way that makes it such a way one to be able to make more people known about this issue and just all issues of intersectionality? How can you do that on a broad spectrum across the board, I mean, especially in conservative states, by nature? As
well, I think the most important thing is raising awareness, of course, but also an important thing that occurred to me while you were asking the question is the media. And I mean everything in the media that I was referring to in the paper. The images of trans folk that I was given when I was growing up in the 70s and 80s were really negative images. And I actually, because I knew who I was and I identified with those people about those negative images, I actually came to believe really negative things about myself and did that. And so one of the most important things is to not patronize media that is in any way transphobic. Right now, where we get that the most is in comedy. So somebody like Dave Chappelle, who is a great comic, but he's transphobic. Yeah, Gervais, again. He's clearly doesn't care about finding out about what he talks about and rather just punch down when he tells jokes. I think it's important. One of the big important things to do is to not patronize that stuff. Make it so that the images of trans folk in the media are more positive. An example of this would be the television, the FX television show, which is sort of about the Paris's burden documentary. Gay and trans folk who live in Harlem in the Black community in New York piece of presentation is where they dress up and walk down like an aisle and everybody's watching them. And they win this contest because they were more legal, lose the contest because they were. That show actually has a very honest and accurate portrayal of trans. Oh yeah, that one is problematic. What's problematic about Girl on Netflix is that it focuses on the trauma involved with this particular trans person. And there's so much sensationalizing of the trans experience. And it's usually focusing on the trauma and the actual physical transition. And there's just too much focus on that. There's too much sensationalizing of that. So I actually think that's a problem for that. Although it's not fully on transphobic, it's not like it's a trans invalidity. It's just everybody always wants to see before and after pictures. They want to know what surgeries you've had. They're interested in dramatic things that you might have done, like cut your penis off, right?
Or something like that.
And yeah, I mean, trans people do, there is trauma, and that's important, but they also normalize. I think we need to normalize being trans, so that doesn't seem like trans people are
people can
have I'll take one more question.
Kind of about the same, what Shannon introduced you with the other word. How have you seen like trans issues? Like, what are like the main trans issues you've seen people like things that they have to come to kind of first with now with like transgender kind of relevant topics?
Yeah. Well, I have two papers on this that are coming out, and you'll be able to read those when they come out, or I can send them to you. So there's a lot of issues. But I will say this. The LDS Church put out the Proclamation of Family in the 90s, and they were attempting to block gay marriage. I mean, that was the purpose of the Proclamation of Family, was to build theology that they could use to justify their legal push against gay marriage. So they essentially, what they were trying to do was, in a way, with that, make sure that the status of LGBT people in the community is seen as being problematic, right? And of course, the official church position is with respect to trans, if they've had what they call the transsexual operation. If they have that, then they will be excommunicated, and they cannot, if they do get back in the church or they get into the church, they can't actually have other temples and can't play any group of members of the church.
Is that including hormones? Surgery.
No, just the surgery. Yeah, it doesn't include hormones. So they've left that open. And if you look at the
can't, because cis people take hormones, so they can't use that as a benchmark, or they have to use it as brutal surgery.
Interestingly, so they use the proclamation to try to justify this, but if you think about it, the proclamation says gender is eternal. And binary trans folk can just say the same thing. Yeah, gender is eternal. That's my eternal gender, is my what my spirit gender is. It doesn't exclude transgender folk. They're confused. Oaks, Dallin Oaks is very confused. He still doesn't know what a trans person is.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much.